The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
Daywalkers and Night Stalkers, it's me, your twisted Southern Horror Queen, coming to you live from under a full moon right here in southeastern Louisiana. I've got some creepy madness lined up for you folks tonight. So if you haven't already, grab a tasty adult beverage, kick out the kids, dim the lights, and lock the doors, because we're about to get our scary on. How about if we kick it off tonight with a vampire legend? You know, it's been a while since we talked about one of the undead, so I thought tonight I'd tell you about the Highgate Vampire. Now, Highgate is like this 200-year-old cemetery in London, and it's got a long, crazy, haunted past. In the early 1800s, a rather prestigious estate stood on the grounds, and the rumor was it was haunted as hell. There's actual documentation from 1808 of encounters with ghosts that had this top hat, and he had a black cloak draped around him, and he was dressed in Victorian-era clothing. Well, at some point, this whole estate was abandoned, and rumors ran rampant that the owners had actually been driven from the home by these malevolent spirits, so yeah, it sat empty and rotten for quite a few years. Well, later on, the grounds were purchased for next to nothing, because nobody wanted to live in this haunted estate. So in 1839, the Highgate Cemetery was opened. Now, the cemetery was beautiful, so of course it became the spot to rest in peace. Folks were paying shit tons of money for a plot there, and every monument or mausoleum that was put up was far more fantastic or elaborate than the last one. So in time, as the number of graves started increasing, so did the legends of ghosts. But things changed after Germany bombed London during the Second World War. Highgate suffered massive damages. Some of the graves and crypts were blasted open, revealing the decaying corpses that had been laid to rest within them. After that, the cemetery began to fall into further ruin, and by the 1960s, it was considered an eyesore. The once high-profile homes that all surrounded the cemetery were also falling into ruin, and the entire area became a favorite hangout for vagrants, addicts, vandals, and runaways. Well, during the 70s, the last remaining neighbors that were still living there were reporting occult activities. So they said supposedly the same group would often be seen entering the cemetery at nightfall, and there was usually at least one of them there during the daytime, too. Many folks reported that while they were visiting the graves of their loved ones, they were followed and watched by the entire time that they were there by a member of this satanic affiliation. It was also during this time that reports of the specter started to resurface. The entity was seen as a tall, dark shadow with glowing eyes that wore this hat and cape. Again, just like the one that was documented in the 1800s. Everybody that had encountered this being swore that they were frozen in place the second they laid eyes on him. So along with these reports came the discovery of dead animals scattered all over the cemetery. All of them had had slashed throats, and their carcasses had all been completely drained of blood. So, was it the same ghost? Yeah, I think so. Check this out. The legend says that in the mid-1800s, the casket of a royal vampire from Wallachia had been smuggled into the cemetery. Okay, so side note here, folks. Wallachia sound a little familiar? Yeah, it ought to. Remember Vlad the Impaler, son of the Dracul, prince of Wallachia? So yeah, Highgate just got a little bit more interesting, right? Anyway, back to the legend. In life, it was said that the occupant of that coffin had been a medieval nobleman who practiced black magic. His followers used this coffin to smuggle the undead king into the cemetery, where eventually he came to rest. Enter the satanic cult. There had been little to no activity near this nobleman's grave for decades until this occultic group started performing their rites and rituals. It's them that's said to be responsible for conjuring the undead royal from his slumber. The first new report of the vampire came in late 1968. His towering dark figure was spotted floating around in the cemetery. Two amateur ghost hunters sneak into this open vault and they watch the entity until it disappeared into another massive mausoleum and it never resurfaced. So these two nutjobs actually start examining the mausoleum inside and out. While they're inside, they found nothing out of the ordinary, but once they started looking around outside, they discovered a trail of blood drops. They followed the trail back to this other area in the cemetery, and that led them to another vault that was filled with huge coffins, and that's where their investigation stopped. Not long after this impromptu investigation, another report comes in from two girls that were walking home from one evening from a friend's house that lived near that cemetery. So on their way past, they spotted this same apparition. They stood frozen in place as they watched it float around the graves, and they said that it was actually watching them too. Well, once it disappeared, the girls were released from their paralyzed state and they decided to run home. One of these girls said that she actually started receiving nightly visits from this vampire and she had the blood loss to back up her claims. Now, only days after this encounter, another young couple was walking the same path. Suddenly, the chick starts screaming. There's something hideous hovering behind the gate's iron railings. Then her fiancé saw it. They both stood frozen to the ground as the specter held them in thrall, just like those other two little girls before them. After that, it was on. Everybody and their grandmama was reporting having encounters with this vampire. Both the local police station and the newspaper were inundated with calls and visits, and within weeks of the first reported spotting happened, the first human corpse was found lying in the middle of the path that led through the cemetery. You got it. Lacerations to the throat and drained of all blood. Now, Sean Manchester was one of these enthusiasts that researched and documented and hunted this vampire. In 1974, he claims that he discovered the resting place of the creature in an old Gothic-style house that sat on the edge of the cemetery. He said that he induced this ancient remedy, and then he proclaimed that the vampire wouldn't rise again. Well, Manchester may have been successful in binding the vampire in his grave for a little while, but the undead, they don't stay dead. In 1991, reports began to surface again. A man named Declan Walsh said he saw this extremely tall, dark figure wearing a hat and cape glide through the locked gates of the cemeteries before it disappeared. Notice, he said glide. Walsh stated that the ground was covered in dried leaves, and there was no sound of leaves crunching as the vampire made its way through the gate. Well, reports continued piling up, and in 2012, a visitor actually photographed the entity, and it's a pretty good picture, too. The image in this photo is exactly as the Highgate vampire has been described since it was first spotted in the 1800s. You can see this tall, dark, and looming figure of a man wearing a top hat and a cape as it is emerging behind this tree. And now, I actually have another vampire story to tell you about. Now, they say vampire, I say demented freak. I'll let you guys be the judge of that. So this is the vampire of Sacramento. This dude named Richard Chase killed 6 people during a 4-week span. But he didn't stop there. Chase cannibalized their remains, had sex with their corpses, and finished his binge off with drinking their blood. From what I've read, the warning signs were there when he was a kid, but his mother chose to ignore the fact that her son was freaking deranged. Let me tell you a little bit about this little sick bastard's background. Chase was brought up in a strict household. He was physically abused by his father on a regular basis. In response, he acted out by drinking at a young age, starting fires and killing or mutilating animals. Later on, as a teenager, Chase was pretty well known with the ladies. And he did have a few girlfriends, but he couldn't maintain a relationship because of his little ED issues. Kind of seems like most of the brutal serial killers that we've talked about have had the same malfunction with their gear, right? Anyway, Chase decided he was going to go see a shrink. Well, during his consultation, he admitted that his junk wouldn't work. So the shrink assumed correctly when he thought the cause was likely some kind of repressed rage or mental illness. Well, apparently, Chase didn't care for this diagnosis, so he never went back. The hell did he need a doctor for? He'd already figured out what he could do to cure his little issues through violence. Seems he had a thing for mutilating animals and having sex with dead things. You sick bastard. So as time passes, Chase hadn't become any less delusional. He actually somehow got it in his head that his mother was trying to poison him. Well, Mom had had about enough of all his crazy bullshit, so she drives the father into putting her precious baby boy up in an apartment somewhere, anywhere else other than in their place. So they move baby boy out, and now he's living on his own, and he could get into all kinds of madness without the watchful eyes of his parents constantly on him. And so his crazy kicks into full gear. Chase starts capturing and killing and disemboweling any stray animal he could get his hands on. Well, once dissected, he would run their entrails through a blender, and then he'd eat the disgusting critter smoothie. Raw! Foulness! He actually thought that by doing this, he was preventing his heart from shrinking. In his sick little demented mind, his heart was withering away, and when it became small enough, it would disappear and he'd be dead. Well, Chase's delusions grew more and more insane, and in 1975, he actually injected rabbit's blood into his veins, which of course caused blood poisoning. So the hospital referred him to a mental institution, and they committed his ass, you think, right? But he managed to escape, and then he fled, and he hides out in his mother's house, and that's where they went to go find him, and of course he was captured. Well, this time, they sent his crazy ass to an institution for the criminally insane. Well, of course he fit in there perfect, but after only being there for a short while, the staff nicknamed him Dracula. That's because he was covered in blood one afternoon. Chase had managed to catch two birds through the bars of his windows. He snapped their necks and sucked all the blood from them. During his stay at this institution, he was prescribed a variety of meds, which of course turned him into a walking zombie. When he was so tranked that he could hardly talk, they released him back into the custody of his parents. Well, Mom wasn't really excited to see her son in such a state, so she wanted her little baby boy back. This dumb bitch decides to wean him off of all of his anti-schizophrenic meds, which were the only thing keeping him from doing all kinds of crazy shit. Well, before long, Mama's boy was back. Yep, Chase was stone-cold crazy again. He immediately went back to killing and mutilating and eating stray animals, but now he's developed a rather unhealthy fascination with guns. Some ass clown is actually selling this nutjob guns, and now he's obsessed with practicing his shooting. Fantastic. Then the delusions start running rampant again. Crazy was now convinced that the Nazis were storing poison under a soap dish in order to kill him by turning his blood into powder. He also believed that the same thing was happening to another serial killer known as the Hillside Strangler. Chase is sinking further and further into insanity. He completely abandoned personal hygiene of every kind. Psycho boy here wouldn't brush his teeth or take a bath. He rarely ate, so he's not much more than skin on bones. But one night, right before the shit really hit the fan, he shows up at his mother's doorstep. When she opens the door, he's standing there with this cat in his hands. As he's standing there, she's trying to figure out what the hell he's doing. He bites into the cat's stomach, then smears its blood all over his face. His mother just simply closed the door. This dumb bitch didn't even report him. Not long after that, Chase killed his first victim. It was kind of a test run for his future plans. On December 29th, 1977, 51-year-old Ambrose Griffin, an engineer and father of two, was helping his wife unpack the car when Chase drove by and shot him, then fled the scene. 2 weeks later, Chase breaks into a house that's owned by a young couple. When he breaks in, the husband, David Wallen, was at work, but his pregnant wife, Teresa, was home alone. Chase murders Teresa by shooting her 3 times, but he wasn't finished. He brutalized and raped Teresa's corpse, then desecrated it further by mutilating it, and then he bathed in her blood. So now he takes a bath. Anyway, 2 weeks after that, Chase breaks into the home of 38-year-old Evelyn Miro. Once inside, he finds Evelyn's neighbor, Don Meredith, who he fatally shot at point-blank range. He stole Don's wallet and keys before he stumbles across Evelyn's 6-year-old son, Jason, who'd been hiding in her bedroom after he heard the gunshot. While Chase is running after him, he sees Evelyn's 22-month-old nephew, who he then shot in the head. When he catches up with Jason, he also shot him at point-blank range. Then he finds Evelyn. She was in the bathroom in the tub. He shot her once in the head, killing her instantly, then dragged her body to the bed, sliced her open in various places in order to drink her blood, and sodomized her. He did way more obscene things to these bodies, which I ain't going into, but trust me, it got way worse. Before he could finish, he was disturbed by a knock on the door. Chase grabs the body of the 22-month-old baby and fled. Unfortunately, he fled in Don's stolen car. He goes to his house, mutilated, and then consumed the body of the baby before he dumps the remains at the grounds of a nearby church. 5 days into this horrendous murdering rampage, Chase was on the FBI's radar. The police went to his house, but he refused to open the door, so they hid outside of his apartment, and eventually he surfaced, and they arrested him. When they searched him, they found Don Meredith's wallet, as well as a box which contained bloody wallpaper and a gun covered in blood. When the police searched his apartment, they found the entire place was soaked in blood, and they found the blender he used to make his smoothies out of the remains of people and animals. It was caked in coagulated blood and internal organs. In the fridge, they found some internal organs from Evelyn Miro and Teresa Wallen. The little boy David's brains were in a Tupperware container. Chase was busted beyond a shadow of a doubt. He was found guilty of 6 counts of first-degree murder and sentenced to die in the gas chamber. But due to his completely psychotic nature, even the hard-ass criminal population of the prison was terrified of him. On December 26, 1980, a guard doing rounds found Chase dead in his cell. An autopsy later found that he'd overdosed himself on prison-issued antidepressants, a much gentler death than he deserved, so I think anyway. Well, while we're on dark and looming men, I have a deeply dark and demented individual I want to tell you about. His name is James Patterson Smith, who went by the name of Dave because he's hiding some serious shit, and a lot of it. We'll kick it off where he starts dating this 14-year-old girl. The problem? Smith is like 48 years old, but he's lied, and this kid, Kellyanne Bates, thinks she's dating a 36-year-old dreamboat. So that makes it so much better, right? Not so much. Well, anyway, this poor girl is head over heels with this dude, and she brings him home to meet the parents, who now also think he's 36-year-old Dave Smith. Well, they're not real impressed with him. In fact, they're really concerned about this relationship, so they keep a close eye on him. And at first, it seemed like he had Kellyanne's best interests at heart. He'd even call her mother to discuss different concerns with her, just to make sure everything was all for the best for Kellyanne. So as time goes by and Kelly is spending a lot less time at home, she's spending a lot more time with Smith. And things start changing, like her demeanor and her appearance and her weight. But she always made it seem like things were perfect. There were no problems at all between her and Smith. Well, Mom stumbles on the truth about Dave eventually, and now she knows who he is and how old he is, but she still doesn't know anything about his past. She's only begun to suspect things about his background during Kelly's last couple of visits. I'm thinking nobody in this family has an aptitude that rates higher than a bag of hairballs. Anyway, Kelly would show up looking like she hadn't bathed, she was bruised and sometimes bitten, but she adamantly denied that Smith was mistreating her. She'd then become frustrated with all the questioning, and she'd leave there to return to him. Well, eventually, Kelly cuts off all contact with her family, but from time to time she would send a card. Her parents grew only more concerned because the handwriting on the cards wasn't hers. But their hands were tied. There was nothing they could do about the situation. On April 16, 1996, their worst fears would seem like child's play when they get the news about their daughter's death. Get this. Smith calls 911 and says his girlfriend had accidentally drowned in the bathtub. Police show up at Smith's house and they find blood in virtually every room of the house, indicating there was way more going on with Kelly's death than an accidental drowning. Weeks before her death, Smith had gouged her eyes out and tied her to a radiator by her hair. For at least 3 weeks, she was refused food and water. Scalped in places, her inner thigh was burned with a hot iron. Her arms, legs, hands, and kneecaps had all been completely crushed. Medical examiners found 150 separate stab wounds on her body, including the inside of her mouth, her empty eye sockets. She was mutilated to her face, mouth, nose, and genital areas. Finally, in what probably came as a relief to Kelly, Smith knocked her out with the shower head and drowned her. Smith denied having anything to do with Kelly's murder. He stuck to his story that she somehow accidentally drowned herself in the bathtub, but he didn't admit to abusing her. Of course, she drowned. You dug her eyes out of her head and she couldn't see. This shitastic idiot then tells the investigators that she's inflicted those injuries on herself, making what little abuse that he had been responsible for appear worse than what it really had been. Smith accused her of purposely winding him up by taunting him. His excuse for beating, stabbing, and gouging out her eyes said because she dared him to do it. It had been all her fault because she provoked him into torturing her. Yeah, well, the police didn't buy that, and neither did the jury. It only took an hour for them to find Smith guilty. He was sentenced to life in prison, where I hope he's been ass-raped daily by everybody in cell block C for the rest of his entire life. But that's just me. This is one of only a handful of cases where jurors were actually offered professional counseling in order to deal with being subjected to the horrific police photographs of Kelly's mutilated body and the grisly crime scene. Yeah, I definitely need a refill after that. And it's good timing, too, because we're about to break for a brief word from our sponsors. So go grab another cold one, but don't go far, because I got more scary coming up in the second half of the show. I'll meet back up with you right here at Armed Radio and TuneIn Satellite.
Lynn, you got to get closer to your mic.
Okay. I actually turned it down because of the rain.
Oh, did you? We're in a commercial?
Yeah.
Are you hangry? Know the signs. Uncontrollable yelling.
Why aren't you egg rolls?
Hallucination.
Sushi.
Pants discomfort.
I hate you, pants.
Hangry. It can happen to anyone. Fortunately, there's E24, the app that tells hunger to shut up.
Egg rolls. Thanks, Snoop.
E24. In my medical opinion, it's the best way to order food online, baby.
Hey everyone, I want to tell you all about an amazing salon, Joyce's, located at 132 Ferry Street in Everett, Massachusetts. Joyce's specializes in the latest techniques in coloring, styling, cutting, and beach waves. Joyce's features Sukesha all-natural nutrient products and organic color. Joyce's full-service spa and salon, located at 132 Ferry Street, Everett, Massachusetts. 617-387-6688. Specializing in you.
Hi, my name is Amrita Rupnarine, a.k.a. Valanistima. Amrita means ambrosia, or nectar of the gods. Valanistima means the birth of divine knowledge. Join me every Thursday night at 10 p.m. Eastern for a night talk with Joe Rocks, exclusively on TuneIn Satellite on Armed Radio Global Network, where we will discuss food, culinary art, baking, cooking, food preparation and presentation, bringing you a little bit of the divine knowledge so you can create your own nectar of the gods.
Plan your visit to Savina Vineyards in Woodbridge, Connecticut today. It's a family-owned and operated vineyard that grows premium grapes on 8 acres of land and produces a fine selection of wine on-site in a historic barn. Savino Vineyards is a bronze medal winner in the Amenti del Vino International Wine Competition, and wine tastings are only $7. Visit SavinoVineyards.com to find out more, and follow Savino Vineyards on Facebook. That's S-A-V-I-N-O Vineyards. Or call 203-389-2050 for more information.
For more. That's good, because I found some freaky little stories about some mysterious rides. But not all of them are cars. Check these out. One of the creepiest cases is about Eastern Airlines Flight 401. This was a TriStar jetliner that crashed in a Florida swamp in December of 1972. 101 people died that day, including pilot Bob Loft and flight engineer Don Repo. It didn't take long before eerie rumors started circulating, not necessarily because of the crash, but more like as a result of the crash. Let me explain. Even though the plane was smashed into thousands of pieces on impact, there were some parts that were salvaged from the crash site. Those parts were installed into other planes, and that's where the story gets interesting. Almost immediately after some of these ghost parts were built into these planes, crew members start reporting weird experiences. Most of them swore that they had encountered the ghost of Loft and Repo. They were spotted most often sitting among the passengers, and sometimes they'd even engage folks in conversation. The apparitions were said to be extremely lifelike, right up until the second when they vanished into thin air. The ghost of Loft and Repo usually appeared in or near parts of the plane that had been salvaged from 401. Once one of them appeared to a flight engineer and casually informed him that he'd already made the pre-flight checklist for him. Another time, the face of Don Repo was reported to have manifested in an oven that had been salvaged from Flight 401. He warned 3 crew members that a fire would take place during that flight. So guess what? The plane later experienced an engine fire, and it had to cancel the last leg of its route. Now, officially, Eastern Airlines doesn't comment on the phenomenon. Still, the guardian ghosts of Flight 401 are said to be something of a legend with the company. Rumors say even the company's vice president has encountered them. He was in the middle of a conversation with Loft when all of a sudden, he disappeared right there in front of him. Then there was this chick that had an encounter. She goes and she gets the stewardess because there's a man that's dressed in an Eastern Airlines uniform sitting in the seat beside her, and he's completely unresponsive. So she brings the stewardess back to her seat just in time for both of them to watch him fade away. Later, the passenger identified Repo from a photograph as the man who had indeed been sitting next to her. So if for some reason you're flying Eastern Airlines, keep an eye out for either of these two, because they've made it apparent that the purpose of their afterlife is to look over passengers and crew of any airline that just happens to contain salvage parts from their final flight, Flight 401. How do I know that? That's because Repo appeared to a captain mid-flight in the cockpit, and he told him so. Repo's exact words, "There will never be another crash. We will not let it happen." Next up, a creepy car. During the 60s and the 70s, people in the Soviet Union had plenty of shit to be worried about. First off, there was the Cold War, which was spawned by the many dangers and threats of their own failing government. No doubt, their life was laced with unending doses of terror. But there was this one other thing in particular that scared the hell out of these folks. It was the Black Volga. Nobody knew who drove the Volga. Some said it was priests, some said it was nuns, some swore it was Satan worshippers, and some folks even claimed it was the devil himself behind the steering wheel. The black Volga was a limousine with white rims and curtains that would appear out of nowhere. Sometimes the rearview mirrors actually looked like horns. It was said to abduct children, and it killed anybody who got near it. Most of the time, instantly, but sometimes the victim would mysteriously drop dead exactly 24 hours later. No one knew why it took the children. Some said they were sold to rich Arabs who needed their blood as a cure for leukemia, and some said the kids were just harvested for the organs. Others figured out the kids were abducted and sold to underground sex rings. Regardless of what it was, these kids weren't picked up and dropped off at Disney World. The myth of the Black Volga has widely spread throughout Russia, Belarus, Ukraine, Poland, and Mongolia. Although today there is no hard evidence to support or debunk the theory, it's worth noting that the Volga limos were the most expensive cars available to the Soviets at that time. They were mostly driven by political figures and other Communist Party officials, the very same assholes responsible for the misery of their people. The next tale comes from Stockholm. That's the capital of Sweden. It's hiding a ghastly secret in the subway system. It's a silvery, shining ghost train called Silverpilen, or the Silver Arrow. That's what lurks there. It stops randomly at stations at random intervals. Sometimes the train is completely empty, but sometimes it's packed with ghost passengers. If you're one of the folks stupid enough to board on it, it's said that you may end up in Kimlinge. That's a subway station of the dead, which is actually a real abandoned subway station. Once there, you might never be seen again. But sometimes, folks have emerged back into the world, weeks or even years later. Haunted or not, Silverpilen is a very real train. It's an experimental vehicle that was put together from 8 aluminum-colored C5 carts. While Silverpilen never made it to mass production, this test unit was occasionally used as a backup train during rush hours. Because it wasn't used every day, there's no ads plastered all over it, and the only markings that you can see are like the remains of partially removed graffiti. It's not painted, but it's very chromish. And it looks really stripped down. It's radically different from all the other trains, which makes it an eerie sight when it pulls up at a station. Not a good thing after a hard night of partying. Even though she was rarely active, she was retired in 1996, but is still rumored to haunt the subway workers in abandoned tunnels to this very day. Here's another one that has to do with mass transit. It's 1934 in London. A driver goes into panic mode as he jerks the steering wheel of his car to avoid crashing into a double-decker bus. He died a horrible death when his car hit the wall and exploded into flames. There'd been no rational reason for his defensive driving, but some of the witnesses stepped forward and they offered their opinions of what happened. The driver of that car, like many other locals, had had an encounter with the Phantom Bus of London. Then more accidents started happening, always at the same time, 1:15 a.m., and always at the same place on Cambridge Gardens. Eyewitness accounts were remarkably similar. A speeding double-decker bus had forced a car off the road. When the startled drivers turned around to see this out-of-control driverless bus, there was nothing there. Whatever it had been vanished without a trace. This sucker has been seen by tons of locals spanning between the 1930s and as recent as the 1990s. The ghost bus is described as a very real-looking red London double-decker carrying the line number 7. It always appears hauling ass down the road and straight towards terrified drivers. Its lights are never on and no driver is ever seen. After panicked drivers fight their cars to avoid collision, they turn and look behind them, and I'm sure their middle finger's all prime, and then they're severely disappointed to see that there is no bus anywhere for them to give the one-finger salute. Next up, during World War II, the Italians were having their asses handed to them. As if it wasn't bad enough that their own fascist government and its Nazi allies were terrifying them on a daily basis, and the Allied forces considered them an enemy, The folks in northern Italy had an even bigger and stranger fear. Something was out to get them, and it was personal. That something was a mysterious plane they called Pippo. Nobody knew where Pippo came from, what type of plane it was, or who was flying it. It would come from out of nowhere and start firing its machine guns at anybody in its path. Locals knew the shit was fixing to hit the fan when they heard the distinctive sound of its engines, which was mostly heard at night, but not always. These folks were all terrified of the mysterious phantom plane. Some of them believed it was some evil presence that was specifically after them. Everybody knew to block out all their lights in their house if they didn't want to draw fire or experience any other horror affiliated with Pippo. See, this plane often carried other lethal payloads that were said to include exploding pins and poisoned candy and powerful bombs, which would release its loads randomly on innocent civilians. Even though this legend sounds like a boogeyman story, historians have confirmed that there was something going on. The plane known as Pippo was probably one of a series of British reconnaissance planes. The model that they had used had a distinctive engine sound similar to what was being described by these locals before these deadly and random attacks. Still, this so-called demon plane retained its spot as a ghost in the collective conscious of the locals. It had been, in fact, the root of some of their worst horrors experienced during the war. Alright, next up. So, it's never good when your car starts moving on its own. I've actually had this happen, y'all. With me, it started about after the fifth shot of Cuervo. But that's a different kind of story. In this story, in Cape Town, South Africa, a family and their guests were woke up by this loud crash in the middle of the night. So they get up and they haul ass outside to see their guest cars jumping around in the yard. Eventually, it breaks down a fence before it stops. At first, they thought somebody tried to steal the car, but there was nobody running from the scene. There was no signs of anybody having been in their yard. The car was locked, the windows were intact and rolled up, and even the handbrake was still on. The freaking car had been moving by itself. Well, when the police arrived, they, of course, didn't believe a word of their story. That is, until the car started itself right in front of the police officers. This car roared into life, and it starts jumping backwards until it wedged itself against a hibiscus tree. So, of course, an investigation ensued. The maker of the car claimed that the events were caused by a rusty starter cable. I don't know how the hell they thought that. But anyway, they couldn't explain the roaring sounds that the car was making in front of the witnesses, remember, which included the police. I think it was a poltergeist that was trying to go for a joyride, but that's just me. The next tale is about one of the most famous phantom vehicles in American history. It's a creepy old steam engine that retraces its path to 180 cities every April. It's essentially the ghost of a real funeral train in which Abraham Lincoln made his last trip. People claim that in the ghost train's presence, watches and clocks stop. Now, the president himself isn't seen there. He's kind of represented, though, because there's a coffin on the train that you can see that's got an American flag draped over it, and his ghostly remains are guarded by the spirits of soldiers dressed in Union uniforms. The train is said to emerge from out of a cloud of thick black fog. Its arrival makes the air noticeably heavier, and it gets colder to everybody who's there. As it's making its way down this 1,650-mile funeral procession, but it never actually ever arrives at its historical destination of Springfield, Illinois. Then there's this tale. During World War II, submarines were the badasses of weapons. One of the more dangerous types was the German UB-3 class, which managed to sink 507 enemy ships during the war, including the notorious battleship HMS Britannia. But this one UB-3 sub was particularly dangerous, both to its enemies and its crew. First off, in the building process, it was a complete disaster. There were three men that were suffocated on diesel fumes. Two more were crushed by a falling girder. During its testing stage, one crew member was swept overboard and he was never seen again. Then the very first test dive sank the submarine to the bottom of the sea because of a ruptured ballast tank. The boat and the crew were helplessly stranded on the ocean floor for hours as the interior slowly filled with poisonous gases released by a damaged battery. Now, the vessel was actually rescued. Every man on it that survived, became violently ill. There were actually two that did die from exposure to the gas. Somehow, even after all of this, the submarine was still declared seaworthy. During its early missions, a freak torpedo explosion killed 8 crewmen and an officer. After that, the officer's ghost was reported haunting the ship. And then after that, the captain was decapitated by flying shrapnel. That same night, several crew members reported seeing the dead officer's ghost guarding his headless body. Poor bastard. At that point, the entire crew said they'd had enough and they all requested a transfer, but the German Navy couldn't find a replacement crew until they agreed to perform an exorcism on the entire ship. But it didn't help, though. Just a few months later, an American submarine ambushed the sub and blew it up with their torpedoes. Or did they? Because the American captain later stated that they never had a chance to fire on it. According to him, it exploded all by itself. And then there's this one other creepy and mysterious vehicle. Ever hear of the demon truck from Seven Hills Road? I didn't either, but check this out. Just beyond Ellicott City, Maryland, there are these seven hills with a narrow two-lane road twisting and turning through them. Now, locals are going to tell you, if you're speeding down this creepy little road and you hit the seventh hill at midnight, you're in for a shitstorm. Be on the lookout for a 30s or 40s model style black pickup truck driven by a dark and faceless entity, because he's going to be looking for you. Folks that have reported encounters with the demon truck say that it appears from out of nowhere, going around 100 miles an hour, and it's barreling straight for you, intent on causing a wreck. And trust me, you would be one of many wrecks, because the trees and the pavement on this stretch of roadway are skinned and scarred from numerous fatal accidents that are assumably caused by the demon truck. Dozens of folks have died in the last decade alone, and hundreds of others have been injured. On October 11th of 2011, a family of four decided they were going to investigate the legend for themselves, and it nearly turned deadly for them. Here's what they had to say. "We made sure that no one was driving or walking so we could speed down the hills," the youngest of the group wrote. "We hit about 93 miles per hour and reached the end of the road. We'd seen nothing, so we made a U-turn and we tried again. Still nothing. We tried this about 5 times and we got no results, so we decided that the ghost car legend was pretty much just a myth after all." But see, the thing about ghost stories, though, they never seem to end when you expect them to. They said they raced down the street a little while after midnight just to enjoy the little butterfly feeling you get in your stomach when you're going up and down hills. All of a sudden, this dark-colored truck appears from out of nowhere. "We panicked and drove even faster, hitting about 98 miles per hour, hoping the truck would slow down and back off. If only that had happened. The truck sped up right on our tail, and we expected to get rear-ended. It was just our luck. When we reached the end of the road, the truck disappeared. We don't know what we experienced that night. We still think it was the ghost truck, but we may never know. All I can say is I believe." Now, due to all the countless car accidents over the year, the city was forced to repave the roads, install guardrails, and alter speed limits, which, I don't know about speed limits. I think those are basically suggestions, but that's just me. Anyway, nowadays, there's new housing developments that have popped up all along Seven Hills Road. The landscape's changed a whole lot since the demon truck legend peaked in the mid-90s. What was once a sparsely populated, spooky little stretch of rough pavement is now a smooth and busy road that's lined with these luxury McMansions. You might think that these changes would dial down the legend, but as the land adapted to the times, so's the haunting. In the last few years, fewer and fewer people have encountered this sinister demon truck. Instead, folks have started reporting encounters with a strange robed woman standing in the middle of the road. By the time the figure's spotted, it's already too late, and drivers are forced to either veer off the road or brace for impact, in which case, the entity disappears. Here's a statement from one of those more recent encounters. "He was wearing a black cloak with a hood. Soon as we saw her, we slammed on the brakes, but she didn't pay any attention to us. When we passed her, she looked up and into the car, and we all could see that she didn't have any pupils. Freaked us the hell out, and we hit the gas. But when we looked back, she was gone. We all saw her. She was there." Well, shit, y'all, we've covered a whole lot of scary tonight. From vampires and serial killers to haunted submarines and possessed haunted vehicles. Man, we have just gone all over the place. But, you know, we're getting close to wrapping it up, and I wanted to remind you guys to stay tuned in to ARM Radio and TuneIn Satellite, because we've got one hell of a lineup through the week. A whole bunch of new shows coming up, and I'm not even familiar with the lineup anymore, but I'll tell you about some of my favorite. Of course, there's the Twisted Southern Horror Queen show, where you got to come get your scary on. On Wednesday nights, we got Whiskey Cars and Cigars with Big Johnny Blender. After him is Glenn Spillman with Sports Talk. And then after Glenn comes Matt Hazley with Straight Talk. And then a good friend of mine that we just met at Southern Geek Fest in Hattiesburg, Mississippi, not too terrible long ago, Big Swole Randy Thornton is kicking off his premiere show this Wednesday night. So come and get your swole on. That's going to be some craziness right there. And Randy's a great guy. Also, we've got Pot Talk with Jimmy and Paul. That's a whole different other level of demented right there, but I kind of dig it, so you need to check it out. And of course, there's the Joe Rock Show, there's Val's Show, and Cosmopolitans with Lauren, and there's just more and more popping up every day. All kind of craziness. So just keep it tuned in right here at TuneIn and Armed Radio. Also want to remind you guys, if there's any legends right there in your neck of the woods that you've heard about and you'd like for me to dig into and maybe want to put on a show later in the upcoming future, give me a shout out on Facebook. You can find me under Southern Horror Queen. Drop me a message. Let me know the name of the legend and where it originated. I'd be happy to do some research for you. I'm always into digging up new ghost legends and demons and monsters. That's cool shit right there. Also want to remind you, too, that if you don't get enough scary during your week and you can't wait till next Monday, you can always go to AuthorLynnGibson.com. There you're going to find my books, photos from past events, interviews from past events, links to my blogs, and also a link to Spreaker.com where you can come and get your scary on from all past episodes. So that's about a wrap for me tonight, kiddos. I'm hoping that you guys will check me out here next week on Armed Radio and TuneIn Satellite. So until next week, you guys, keep it creepy. You know I will. Choo, choo. Choo, choo. Choo, choo. Choo, choo. Choo.